That giggle, that curiosity, everything in the world was new for little Marie Juarez.
I had many dreams for her. She was my whole life. When she was born, she was really beautiful. And as she got older, she was a really smart girl.
Marie was not even 2 years old when her mother, Yasmin, made a decision that would change both their lives, to flee the dangerous, impoverished Guatemalan city where she says she lived in fear of an abusive husband.
I would ask her to forgive me. I would say to her, you don't deserve this. Your life is going to change, love.
In search of a better life, Yasmin decided she would seek asylum in the United States and join the tens of thousands of men, women, and children making that dangerous journey north.
I knew about the risks for her, but I would tell myself, she's not the only one. Many children have crossed under the same conditions, and they're okay.
Yasmin and Marie made the 1,500-mile journey from Guatemala through Mexico and illegally across the Texas border safely, only to face tragedy in the country she thought was her family's salvation. What happened to them would shine a stark light on what critics say is an overstressed system of medical care in immigration detention centers.
More family detention means more vulnerable children in the same dangerous system.
Upon crossing the Rio Grande on March 1st of this year, Yasmin and Marie were immediately detained by Border Patrol, and days later, transferred to a family detention center in Dilley, Texas.
Talk to me about Marie's health at this point.
She was normal. She was happy. She was playing with all the kids in her group.
Medical records obtained by ABC News showed there was no indication that Marie was sick when she entered the facility. But that all changed within days.
I would touch her forehead and it was hot. I felt she was coughing too much. There were so many people there, so many sick kids.
Yasmin took Marie to the facility's clinic where staff and medical care is provided by ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement Health Services. A physician's assistant diagnosed the toddler with an upper respiratory infection, prescribed Tylenol and honey packs, and told Yasmin to follow up in 6 months. The next day, Marie's temperature spiked to 104 degrees, more coughing, congestion, and now diarrhea and vomiting. Yasmin took her young daughter back to the clinic. This time, another physician's assistant diagnosed her with an ear infection and bronchiolitis, prescribing an antibiotic and fever reducers.
Did you ever see a doctor at this point?
No.
You think they didn't care that your child was sick?
I think that there were so many people there that it was hard for them to make time to see this little girl or that little boy.
Marie is examined 3 more times, only once by a doctor. But according to Yasmin's legal complaint, Marie keeps getting sicker. Yasmin says she was begging clinic staff to take Marie to the hospital, even asking to be deported so she could take her daughter to a hospital back in Guatemala.
You were so worried about your daughter, you asked to be deported.
Yeah, claro.
Of course, but the answer they gave me is that I should wait.
On March 23rd, Yasmin got some good news. According to her legal claim, a nurse told her that Marie would see a doctor the next morning, but that never happened. Instead, they are suddenly notified they are being released from detention to be sent to New Jersey to reunite with Yasmin's mother, a decision medical experts we spoke to say was inappropriate without a medical exam for clearance to travel.
Nobody told you don't get on that airplane with your daughter.
Nobody was there for us.
It was a grueling 19-hour travel day. Yasmin says along the way, Marie was listless and vomiting. When they arrived in New Jersey, Marie was finally taken to a hospital.
And I asked God for forgiveness, for everything that I did, for having brought Marie here. I begged him with my whole heart. And I said, tell me what to do and I will do it, so long as you save my daughter, Marie.
But the respiratory infection had already taken its toll on her little lungs. After 6 weeks, every single day in a hospital, Marie died with her mother by her side.
Doctors, we shared Marie's medical records with caution that it's impossible to know if she would still be alive today if she had received better care. But they did tell us viral bronchiolitis doesn't have a cure. Usually, it just has to run its course. But they do say that Marie's care at Dilley was troubling.
Right now, more than 42,000 people are held daily in immigration detention centers. Some 14,000 are children. Watchdog groups say at times they're being detained in unhealthy conditions with inadequate medical care and limited access to doctors.
Regardless of what you think about illegal immigration, once someone is detained by the U.S. government, that person is our responsibility.
The moment you're detained, the U.S. government becomes responsible for your health care.
And ethically, we have to make sure we keep those people alive.
That's correct.
For years, Dr. Mark Stern was a paid consultant for the Department of Homeland Security, where he investigated allegations of insufficient or poor health care systems in ICE immigration detention facilities.
Are you surprised people are dying?
I'm dismayed that people are dying. It bothers me tremendously. It doesn't surprise me to the extent that the system that I know of that exists is a broken system. And you get what you pay for. If you design a system or allow a system to be bad, then you get bad outcomes. So from that standpoint, no, I'm not surprised that people are dying. It is preventable.
When you were at the Department of Homeland Security, did you see similar incidents?
I cannot talk about that.
And why is that?
I signed a non-disclosure agreement.
So why would the Department of Homeland Security want you to keep quiet about poor medical practices?
I don't know. You would have to ask them.
Dr. Stern now volunteers his time reviewing medical records of those who died in detention for Human Rights Watch. According to the nonprofit, there have been 81 deaths since 2010, 12 in this year alone. So far, Human Rights Watch has only been able to obtain medical records for 52 detainees who died since 2010. And it says almost half of those deaths were linked to substandard care.
We're seeing cases of people who have been in detention for days, weeks, sometimes years, and develop problems that are easily identifiable and fixable.
Yasmin says they are now seeking justice and have filed a wrongful death claim seeking $60 million from the federal government. In it, Yasmin calls the medical care provided by ICE, quote, woefully inadequate, neglectful, and substandard. ICE says it can't comment on the death of Maria Juarez because of ongoing litigation, but says it takes very seriously the health, safety, and welfare of those in our care. When we come back, shocking allegations of what happened to a father of six in detention.
I told the guard, and he says that they only take them to the hospital when they're dying.
And a former detention center employee speaks out.
Did this cause a danger to the detainees?
My opinion, absolutely.
Stay with us.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.